Mine. Okay, so now I'm going to talk to someone who I haven't spoken to since lockdown. I have no idea what her past 3 months has been like. If it's like the rest of her life, it will have been slightly chaotic. I have missed her. I only get to see her really when we're out doing chat shows and promoting her books. But I am so proud of her because she created this wonderful prize for the Comedy Women in Print. And I think it's in its third year. But anyway, enough of me. Let's introduce her. Helen Lederer, welcome to the afternoon show.
I'm so thrilled. I mean, where have you been? What's been happening? I miss you. And communicating. I can't even use my mouth and my tongue.
I think about you often. You sent me two texts about this, and then I didn't get back to you. And then Amy said to me, gosh, we're getting Helen Lederer in. I thought, thank heavens, because I haven't replied to Helen.
No, you haven't.
No, but only because you're one of those people. I cannot send just one word. I have to send you a whole essay on what's been going on. So before we get on to the women in print, how have you coped in lockdown?
Well, I want to know how you have coped. Today is a particularly strange day. Do you find it's almost as if you've got sinuses, but you haven't got sinuses, sort of like one removed? Are you feeling that at all in the stars?
I hate to go on to aesthetics, and I know there's more important things, but you and I are natural blondes, obviously. I have a regrowth that is like taken up half my head mixed with grey hair. Oh. And my neck represents a turtle because I can't have injections in it. I've just sort of become feral looking, to be quite honest.
What are you wearing? Are you wearing slacks?
I'm wearing very baggy white trousers, but I haven't succumbed to the elasticated waist. Yeah, what about you?
They're white. That's a fashion statement. And you know you can carry some white slacks. I'm not wearing white slacks. I couldn't. Not even on my own. I couldn't. I'd embarrass myself. It's just nice communicating, isn't it? I mean, I've been working very, very hard on the Comedy Women Print Prize, which we'll talk about, which is exciting. But I think some days are great. Have you, you know, at the moment we can meet someone in a garden. I have a thermos where I put my vodka in, drink from my own little cup.
I wondered what time the cocktail hour would start. Yeah,
that's important to me right now, and connecting with people. And you have to have local friends, of course. You have to make local friends more friendly, because it's impossible to see people farther away. I've only got about one local friend. It's quite lonely, Joe, actually.
And this is a really good segue, you are a reader. And as Paul Ross used to say, if you buy a book, you've bought yourself time for yourself. So I think the readers have survived. I mean, I've watched everything on Netflix. There is nothing left for me to watch on Netflix now. You know, even House of Cards, I've watched every single episode.
Have you tried Philharmonia? That's a good one.
No.
Lots of classical music. That's a series. You have to be engaged with something that removes you. I can't watch comedy programmes at the moment. Can you?
Because there's not a lot to laugh about at the moment, to be honest. No. But let's go back to the book, because explain to everybody, is this the third year, Helen?
Well, it feels, doesn't it? Because for your lovely, loyal listeners, because you do have an adoring coterie of populated fans, you have travelled the boards with me, haven't you, and interviewed me and asked me questions, the same questions.
They all remember Crouch End. They all love Crouch End. They love, that was, for my listeners, that was their favourite gig with you.
Oh, God. Through the listeners, we did actually have to flyer the high street, Crouch End High Street, to encourage people to come and not be too scared of us. But because we talk easily with each other, and it's lovely. I'm just remembering how to talk. So what was the question, Joe? About
it's the third year, and you said it feels like it.
Yes, it feels like it. Because, the idea came 5 years ago when I finished my novel and wanted to win a prize, and there wasn't one, so I set one up. That's the thing. But it's not really true. This is, the more I think about it, this is a platform where we can ask different sorts of questions, not that old one like, can women be funny? That is so yesterday, even beyond. It's a platform of a community of encouraging witty female writing. One half of it is the winner of the unpublished prize becomes published. So obviously that's a dream come true, should you be one of those people wanting to get your work published, obviously. And then the published list, we have amazing titles now from the short list that went from the long list, as we say, where everyone is, I hate people not being on the list, but then I'm not a judge. Amazing judges, Joe Scanlon, Paulie McGlynn, Marion Keyes supported this from the beginning. So it's actually attracting and attractive to people who want to do something real and encouraging and sort of move the conversation forward a bit. I think a lot of it is about, right now, you started with the lockdown, Joe. I mean, it's like, we are in a very, very different time, obviously. Wanting more authenticity, maybe less interest in the sort of da-da-da-da life, do you think?
I think I'm looking... A couple of things jumped out at me of the list. I am a huge Posy Simmons fan. So Cassandra Dark is on the shortlist for humorous graphic novels. I mean, Posy Simmons was a trailblazer, amazing writer. And this is about a reclusive art dealer and fraudster faces difficult life choices.
From it's
the
our life.
Doyen, exactly, from the doyen of comics. But I love this. I love the fact you do unpublished comic novels. I don't, you know, it's such a great idea. But the title, this is what immediately, I know, never judge a book by its cover, but I love this. You Can Drop Me Here by Julia Walter. How often have I uttered that phrase? And I just love the fact she writes about a 40-something divorcee has an unlikely romance with a man who lives in a van. And this is from Curtis Brown creative graduate Walter.
Well, a few of them, I have to say, have gone, like with stand-up comedy, they never have courses in my day. There are courses now that focuses the mind and encourages, you know, people to write. But you've picked out, as you would, you've championed an unpublished writer. Are you still there?
Yeah, no, and also, I shouldn't say this to you, but when we get press releases from publishers, the publisher, it carries a lot of weight. So Curtis Brown is one of our favourites, and I had no idea they ran courses.
I know. Maybe you and I should go on a course, but you never have any
you
time.
You can't be taught anything, Helen.
You're
a best-selling author.
I'm not good at managing people. I think that's a little area. I'm wondering if there's a managing people course that I could go on, because that I've just called myself the mayor of Quip now. It amused me slightly. It's this kind of weird, I should maybe have a medallion. It's this weird post where I care about this so much. I'm doing it, but it's not my proper job. And so I have to sort of turn myself into another kind of person when really, I want to be doing more stand-up, but who's going to come to that? Memoir, haven't written yet because I'm doing Quip, but so the idea is, as you picked out, it's graphic. Where are the female cartoonists, you see? So it's shining a light and making people view witty content in a different way. And it's fascinating when you do start listening to interviews where people still Joe are just in another age when they still ask that question. Can women be funny? Like, they really think that would be the starting point of a conversation when you go, do you think we have moved on from that? When you look at all these amazing, witty, funny, celebrated, reliably funny books that are published that you can get on Amazon for a couple of nicker, I think. But when can we go out for a drink, Joe?
Every time I listen to you, I think I need to see more of her. I need to tell people that I say this every single time. When Helen and I do Q&As with her, we did one in an amazing place in Hampstead. Oh, that was such a good night.
Oh my gosh,
I loved that. The best bit, I really, now I've started vlogging, I'm going to start filming you in the dressing room because it's so funny.
Yeah.
Helen has no confidence in herself. So she will arrive dropping literally everything and then say, I've brought drinks for all the audience, literally all the audience. And I said, I don't think they need it. There is a bar. No, I've brought this for them. And you're going to do this and I'm going to do this. And then we go out, we don't do anything that you've prepared.
No.
Every gig you bring a sort of flip chart, which we never even have time to look at.
Because you think so fast. The point is, you know, you think fast, you also listen. So there's, luckily. So otherwise, there's that kind of dynamic that you just go, we don't know where it's going to go. And then when we did this talk to the really interesting people in the Hampstead, It went into all sorts of areas, and you just don't know where you're going to be. But Barb
Did you say Barb Young sends her love?
Yes.
Can you tell Barb? Yeah. I left a voicemail on someone's phone thinking it was hers.
Oh, no.
I hope she's listening because I left a voicemail. And he phoned back and said he was Chris and it wasn't Barb.
But that's so different.
I then emailed Barb. The reason I'm talking about Barb Young is everyone like you, everyone knows her on my show. And she was the first person, unlike you, Helen, who phoned me in lockdown and said, Joe, how are you? Are things okay? I'm with my mum. And I've been trying to get hold of her.
Well, I'll pass that on then.
You pass.
But now I'm feeling, now this is an interesting thing about the lockdown behaviour, going back to that, because that is engaging, as well as Comedy Women in Print, which is my passion project. So people will go onto the Comedy Women in Print website and see what's happening and all these amazing, exciting writers. But in lockdown, do you not find that the right thing to do? I should have done that for you. I should have said, how are you? You should have done that for me,
I know,
Jo.
That's what I've said to you. I didn't even answer your texts.
No.
Only because it was too much to say. Have you been Zooming your friends?
Yes, but the thing about the Zoom, with the fact you do have to put a bit of makeup on, and going back to your root problem, which is quite a nice visual image, there is some powder that you can put into your roots that can, obviously it's not going to mesh with the grey, but there's so many things. Oh, God. Can I just tell you about my eyebrows? So I thought I sent off for some tint for the eyelashes and the eyebrow all in one, but got confused and put blue black on the eyebrows.
Oh, no.
And I have blue black eyebrows, but it happens very quickly. But these are things you have to do.
God, that's going to look startling in your next Zoom meeting,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes.
Helen,
hair grows. Yeah,
if people go onto the website of Quip, which I love, the Comedy Women in Print Prize, can they vote?
Oh, well, that's an interesting thing. Maybe for next year, for the people's vote. You see, every time somebody comes up with a genius new idea, I go, fine. And then you have to locate a lot of other people to enact that idea, because I can't do things like that. No, at the moment, they can't vote, but that is a really right. They'll be voting next year.
Yeah, but you got this together, and I'm really proud of you. If they go on, though, they can have a look at the shortlist.
They'll see the shortlist, and they'll listen to Witty Wednesdays, which is me talking to authors on Instagram, don't laugh, and we've put it all on the website, so you can hear these crazy conversations like you and I have with writers and a glass. It's compulsory, we have to have a glass of something. And and that is an example of me going, oh my goodness, technology, Instagram, press a button.
Honestly, you're using all of these platforms to your advantage, Helen.
I'm on a platform.
Have you interviewed Jeanette Winterson?
She's on the list.
See, I haven't.
No. So Jeanette Winston, you would think, would one not quite rightly, oranges are the only fruit that I saw on television, didn't really. But here we have a very intelligent but witty, very good, very witty. There's sex bots in there. I actually didn't know the phrase. If I said to you sex bot, would you know what that is?
Bot or bop?
B-O-T. It means like a doll, and it's sort of looking at sex dolls in a conference. It's just very witty and amusing in that particular section.
I'm actually looking at my producer, because at some point she's going to say no. We'll have to remove it off the iPlayer.
No,
I think we can say sex bot.
Sex bot.
I've now said it three times.
Oh, that's when I said Kit Kat several times when I was on Woman's Hour once, and I saw the poor producer in her hands, but it was a nervous Tourette's thing. Also, what was I going to say? Remember in chapter 11 on my book, Losing It, which you know really well, and there's a colonic, and you see, 5 years ago, one could talk about colonics, not in a totally, like, out their way, but...
Christopher Biggins came into my studio straight after a colonic once.
Oh, really?
Yes.
How was he? Was he
was full of vigour. He said he's never felt more energised.
Well, maybe you have to keep doing them then. No, but it's interesting about fashion and concepts and trigger words, because things, you know, like the kind of content of this list has got what is sort of darkly comic now, Nina Stibb one, hilarious about dentistry, and that appeals to me, you know, just something that you wouldn't necessarily know. I'm sounding drunk, but I've had an apple just before, about dentists. But then you go, to be funny about something you don't know about is very funny, isn't it?
Oh, gosh, I'm just getting so many emails. Sorry. Michelle's just emailed me saying, I just love this person. Who is she? She's Helen Lederer. I mean, she's Helen Lederer. You need to Google Helen Lederer. Everyone knows Helen Lederer.
No, but it's lockdown. I'm not used to doing sentences and listening politely.
How's your darling husband?
Oh, just putting up with this. Today I said, could he put an app called Compress onto my app? Oh, no, onto my phone. There's just so much technology. But we're carrying on. We walk around the park in the morning.
Wonderful. He is a long suffering. Well, honestly, when we do these gigs, we did one in the middle of Somerset or somewhere.
Yes.
And you said to him, drive away and come back in a few hours. No, and he did.
Oh, yes, because this is the norm. Because I don't know about you, but would you want to be naked in front of your parents on stage?
No. Exactly. No. I never wanted anyone I knew to ever come to a first night.
As an actress, you would know this, you see. So we are similarly appointed. We get on, we get into the zone, we do what we have to do with a bit of a drink in the dressing room. But how is it for a BBC? Do you just work all the time? And how's your life changed? Look, what's going on?
She should have done this on a WhatsApp. She's doing it on air. My life, I'm still here. We have our temperature taken every time we come in the building.
Wow. Yes.
And there's a one-way system, so we're going past Sophie Raworth on the way in.
But she's
fine, but we leave through the tradesman's entrance. And if you woe betide, you don't follow the one-way system. You have to go all the way back to the spiral staircase.
And do you see anybody else, Jo? I mean...
George Alagaya, Sophie Raworth, I'm trying to think of...
I meant Sophie.
Evan! Like oh, my gosh! Evan, who's the guy that presents PM?
Davis.
Evan Davis. Yeah. So I had my phone smashed, right? I dropped it and I had it repaired in reception here at the BBC,
shop there for you. But anyway, go on. Yeah,
but we were social distancing and he was in PPE. And he was mending my phone, not Evan, the man who was mending my phone. And then he said, do you know anyone called Evan? And I've forgotten his name again, Davis.
Davis, yeah.
And I said, good God, yes. He's he presents PM.
He's an economist. Yeah.
He came, he said, oh, well, I've got his phone here. So Evan came out in mufti.
Meaning?
He was in a stretch denim.
Stretch denim, what, all in one? Or
Oh, my God.
And what's the significance?
Evan Davis in an all-in-one denim onesie. No, he had sort of skinny drainpipe denims. I never see him in that. I always see him in a shirt and tie.
No, and do you think that what caused that change of style?
I think because he's doing radio, he's not in Vision. Whereas for me, it's always a white trouser.
Your clothing is very classy, and you know about shoulders. You have a good shoulder. You know how to do shoulder sort of contouring. But listen, are you okay there? Do you sit with people outside on a Saturday morning?
No.
With a friend?
No, we don't. We're fine here. We don't have anyone coming in. Otherwise, you'd be here. There's a skeleton team. Loads of the people who contribute to this radio station are working from home. Amy, my producer, is here. Yeah. The Preet, who assists, is working from home.
And are you working harder? I mean, are there more people like me saying, please, can I come on and talk?
Amy, back me up on this. I've said I don't want any celebrities on. You made the cut because you're my mate and everybody loves you.
Thank you.
Barb, if you're listening, you can come on.
She'll come now. Well, she'll have to get upset otherwise.
We've just talked about the situation. That's what we do.
Really?
Day in and day out.
Actually, I must ask about that. That's interesting because when anybody... I mean, this the prize is for other people. You could link it to saying reading in lockdown, finding amusing things in lockdown. There is a value. I mean, it could be seen as a tenuous link, but I'm not, alas, in a Netflix to talk to you about that. And I wouldn't really feel that's appropriate. So are you saying that the tenor is, look, let's talk about what is really concerning us and how we can improve our lives?
And also, we actually started a book club and it went very well. In fact, we haven't done it for this week. But yes, because people are reading, we're promoting reading, which is another reason you've come on.
Fantastic.
Helen, we must wind it up. So
yep,
the best thing we can do is send everybody to the website.
Comedy Women in Print. And there is a Just Giving link, but I understand in these times that isn't... It is only to propel it forward to give other people a chance to get published. It's a choice. I say that respectfully. But do look and listen to my Witty Wednesdays. Not as good as Lovely Joe Good's Chatty Chat, but you've explained a lot to me now. I really feel I know what's going on.
Can I just say, I'm just reading these. These are just to flatter you, but I'm going to read them out.
Oh, go on. I need it.
Jane has just said, this is the best chat I've heard on the radio forever. Jerry, who is local to you, he runs Dr. Doolittle's, the oldest pet shop in Streatham. He said, oh, my God, how much do I love Helen Lederer? How much do I love listening to her chatting to you? Robert says, oh, Helen Lederer, I could listen to you two forever. Michelle says, I love it. I absolutely love it. I've no idea what the two of you are talking about, but I love it.
And you didn't put through the other comments, but no, that you've lifted my spirits. Thank you.
I'll let you get back. Will you send my love to Barb Junger and your husband? Oh, I love her. Honestly, I just can't imagine her in lockdown. It'd be like gathering kittens.